frage ihn doch vielleicht mal, ob er nicht warten möchte. Die machen jeden Monat eine Sitzung.
Da muss man fähig sein, mir Vorlagen zu machen. Und in der Kooperation von deinem Büro und meinem Büro. Nicht einzeln. Ich habe das Ding heute Morgen ja überzählt, aber nur das Papier dabei.
Es gibt ja nur dieses Vorbereitungspapier, das er gemacht hat. Und Sie haben das doch, das hat er hier vorgetragen in der weiteren Vorstand, wo du
Büro gesitzt. Von euch bewertet haben,
haben wir gemacht.
Habe ich nicht.
Es sind drei Punkte, mehr nicht.
Ich habe es aber nicht.
Gut.
Ich will anständig vorbereiten. Genau wie ich das gesprochen habe.
Das haben wir jetzt draußen mal geschickt, das Ding.
Dann erklärt mein Büro, dass es ein Zusammenhang hat.
Gut.
Papier, Bewertung, Vorgespräch. Kolleginnen und Kollegen, der Kollege Please be quiet on the benches of the external service and on the commission.
Whoops.
They follow you, Federica, not me. thank you very much that you had agreed to inform us about the review of European neighborhood policy, which was formally decided in the college meeting this morning. I welcome here the High Representative, Vice President of the Commission, Federica Mogherini, and Commissioner Johannes Hahn. I think it's needed that we had such a review. It was already needed as it was decided to do that. But if we see the development in the South and what happened in Paris, which had also a certain context with these questions, when we see it in the East, where we have, despite the Minsk agreement, not a satisfying solution until now, and see the situation in Moldova and Georgia, which gives also reasons for concern in a certain way, then I think it's needed to have this here. And Federica, perhaps it's also possible to make some remarks in the context of your presentation about the foreign ministers meeting on Monday, because it's in a certain context, so that we can discuss that together. I will not make an introduction myself, but I believe that we should have a stringent, coherent discussion, which means that let's see how long the presentations will be, that the coordinators have 2 minutes, perhaps if the presentation is too long, 1.5 minutes only, and the other members 1 minute if we have some time that people can speak, because 1:15, we have to close, I have heard. And so there is not very much time for this discussion, but anyway, we will follow on that because we will make reports about this, and therefore we have, I think, hearings and preparations of reports, so that in the course of the next weeks we will follow up. So let's see, this is not at the final debate, but introduction of the debate, because it might have further impacts on our future policy. Hope it will have further impact. High Representative, Vice President, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Elba. Elmar, thank you. Today, just now in the college, we adopted proposals on a reviewed European neighborhood policy. And this follows 1 year of broad consultation with all different, very different and relevant stakeholders, which doesn't mean only partner countries, governments, but also obviously member states, European institutions, the European Parliament itself, but also civil society, NGOs, parliaments, national parliaments, business, think tanks, universities at large. And overwhelmingly, different views all converged in saying that it is a good idea to keep one framework for our partnerships in the region, both East and South, but at the same time, as overwhelmingly as they indicate to us that, yes, we keep one framework, there was a clear indication that we need a change in the way in which the policy is conducted, somehow a new phase, a new start. And the current political environment we have in not only in Europe, but also in the region, tells us very clearly that we have to shift attitude and way in which we interpret our neighborhood policy. I do like this when I say neighborhood policy, because I believe the main message that we receive from the political environment, from the security environment, from our partners in the region, and also from our own European citizens in most of the cases, is that we need to shift from an approach that was based on the assumption that we have a European Union at the center and neighbors around us approaching more or less to us, to a vision based on partnership among equal partners that have common problems, in some cases common opportunities, and that need to build instruments and platforms to work together in an effective way, both on the challenges and on the opportunities. And acknowledging that the challenges and the opportunities we have in common among us are different from the ones of the past. With Elmer, we were thinking that maybe this could have been also a way of for me to debrief you a little bit about the Foreign Affairs Council. Actually, just realized that normally we would do that in a different format, so that would probably not be the best idea to do. But for sure, I can tell you that Monday and Tuesday, with the foreign ministers on Monday and with the defense ministers yesterday, obviously all the focus was on the terrorist attacks on Friday in Paris, but also on attacks that just a few hours before happened in Beirut, on attacks that previous days were happening over the Egyptian flies on a Russian plane, and again during the Turkish electoral campaign in Egypt, in Iraq, potentially some months ago in Tunisia. This tells us that in the neighborhood we are sharing the same kind of security threat. So that's also why I said also yesterday, together with the French defense minister, Jean-Yves Le Drian, it is with Paris all of Europe that is attacked, but it is not only Europe that is attacked. It's somehow our common roots, our common civilizations jointly that are attacked. And we are in this together. We are in this together, as well as we were finding out in the last months, for some of us in the last years, that we were in the management of the refugee crisis and the migration crisis together, that we were together and we are together in trying to find a solution and an end to the Syrian war, as we were together sitting around the same table in Vienna last Saturday or 2 weeks before, and as we are together as neighboring countries of Libya to try and start a Libyan government of national accord. We share in the south and in the southeast for sure the same kind of challenges and potentially the same kind of opportunities. And again, I was there last week in Ukraine and in Georgia. I know Commissioner Hahn is going there tomorrow.
Today.
Again, here also we share threats of instability, first of all, in some cases military threats, energy, common challenges and opportunities also to the east. So the whole security and political environment around Europe tells us that we have to move to this partnership approach and to have to adapt the instruments we have, the institutional instruments we have, to make sure that this new start in partnerships manages to build on solid basis. And that has a certain sense of urgency. Obviously, I would leave for Commissioner Hahn to go more in detail on the reviewed policy in itself. I would just mention five principles on which we worked together. And also, let me stress together, because I think that over this year we have done everything in a very coordinated way. And I would like also to thank our services that have worked together over this year and are continuing to work together after today to put this in a sense of a full partnership also inside the European institutions. Few principles around which we've built these proposals. First, the focus on economic development and job creation, especially for young generations. This is relevant inside Europe. This is not for this group of members of parliament to discuss, but still, we are all politicians. We all know what it means for our youth, young people. But this is true especially for the neighborhood, both to the south and to the east. Offering economic development opportunities, building jobs, and not only educational but also adequate jobs for the youth of both the Mediterranean region and the east of the European continent is crucial also for the stability and the resilience of the countries and the societies, and so of the European one. Second, energy cooperation. We have received indications from all the stakeholders that this is one of the fields, not only to the east but also to the south, that can offer more ground in terms of possible development of common chances and common opportunities. Third, security. You know, ENP didn't include security instruments so far. It was not a focus. It is quite obvious, I think, today that we have to include instruments that provide us tools that on which we can work together with our partners, both in the East and in the South, building more resilient countries and societies to external and internal threats, but also work very much on a wide range of new areas of cooperation, focusing, for instance, on conflict prevention and on security sector reform, finding the right balance between efficiency of the security sector reforms and openness of societies, respect of human rights and values that are at the core of the European Union. Fourth, and obviously, always on the security part of the work on terrorism, countering radicalization, tackling the financement of terrorist networks, working very much on organized crime, working on corruption as well, different strands of a work on security that has to be part of the picture. Fourth, the work on migration, the irregular one and the regular one, because these two things have to go together. On one side, the work on, and the third element, which is the protection of refugees. On the protection of refugees, working more and more with our partners to strengthen their own and our own also, but this is again for our side of the story to be told, but strengthening their capacity to protect, to welcome refugees and guarantee that this their asylum systems and their protection systems are strengthened. On the legal migration, on the regular migration, support to mobility, taking into consideration our demographic and economic needs, short and long term, because Europe also needs regular migration, but also people-to-people exchanges. Think of students, scholars, researchers, business. There is a network that needs to be encouraged and needs to find easy ways to connect to Europe. But then also the irregular migration work we have to do, and in particular the common management of the flows, the fight against smugglers and traffickers networks, and the links with other criminal organizations, and a common work on returns and readmissions, including sustainable reintegration of returnees in host in local communities that could also provide for good opportunities for economic development of local communities. Fifth and last, extend our work also to the neighbors of the neighbors. So going beyond the neighborhood strictly intended, and work with other key partners to tackle some of the challenges we have in common. Think, for instance, of Africa when it comes to migration or energy or security or health. Think of all the work we've done on Ebola just last year and seems so far away. So interests that we have, because there are channels open from the neighbors to our neighbors, through our neighbors to Europe. I'll finish here just by saying that in terms of process, as you said, Elmar, this is the beginning. I mean, not the beginning, because we've been working on this for 1 year, but in terms of our institutional work, it's not the last chapter. We will now, after this exchange with you, with the Parliament, discuss the proposal with the Member States, with partner countries, individually. We've met yesterday together the ambassadors of all the countries involved, having this dialogue among equal partners. And we will try to adopt lighter working methods, which is in itself quite a challenge, but trying to go beyond the bureaucratic approach that sometimes we have in dealing with our partners, sometimes also they have in dealing with us, trying to move on a more political basis, and also continuing to find effective way to involve and engage with the civil society everywhere. And obviously keeping the European Parliament fully on board and fully part of our work.
Thank you sehr. Before Johannes Hahn.
Thank you very much. Before I give the floor to Johannes Hahn, could I just bring one point to your attention? I would ask that this Article 42.7 request, there will be a proposal to AFET as to how exactly that might be shaped up. That would be a job for CEDE, and I think that would have to be, we need to ensure that the staff on our committee have received an information note about what the potential practical consequences would be for that. And if you could agree with that way of proceeding, then I would note that as a job of work that we have approved. And I will, without further ado, give the floor to Johannes Hahn. Thank you very much, Elmar. Picking up on what the High Representative was just saying, let me say a few points straight off about matters of principle. The neighbourhood policy has undergone a review process, not because we think that everything that's been done over the last decade has been wrong, and I'm making that point because people do ask about whether that's the case. I'm saying it because it is quite clear that after 10 years of garnering of experience, you would necessarily wish to bring together all that experience and think about how to shape a strategy that would, for the coming years, make the relations that we have with our neighbours work. And it is against that backdrop that this paper has been drawn up and is to be seen as a guideline for how we would wish to cooperate with our neighbours, and also thinking about relations left, right and centre. We in the European Union have also try to articulate our own interests more than in the past and put them on the table. And I think in doing so, perhaps we were a little bit in the past too reticent. We're keen on peace and stability and prosperity, and were we to achieve all of that, we would benefit from that in Europe. I mean, just think about the migratory pressures at the moment. They wouldn't be happening if there were peace, stability and prosperity in our neighbourhood. And I think that would reduce what we wish to do in the coming years to the one word, stability. We wish to bring about a stabilization of our neighbourhood because there are over 20 million refugees and displaced people in the local vicinity and in our neighbourhood. We've got more than 10 armed conflicts going on in our backyard, and there have been developments in the rule of law, which it seems to me, compared with the situation in previous years, have led to a deterioration, or certainly haven't been an improvement. And it is against that backdrop that it turned out that it was necessary for us to try and establish the cornerstones of our policy. And we've often discussed it in the past. And the consultation process that we had with 250 organizations, countries, NGOs, and private individuals who participated in that have confirmed what we had in the draft version of this back in March. So the four cornerstones are, first of all, a more differentiated way of approaching each of our neighbouring countries. A tailor-made approach, if you like, for each of our neighbours. Secondly, we will focus on the thematic aspects. Federica Mogherini has referred to the fact that security policy in its most comprehensive guise is going to accompany us to the end of our term in office. We need to think about this in terms of energy, and we also, as has already been said, need to think about people to people, with a main focus on young people, on youth, and not to forget the economic development aspect as well, which is overarching. Thirdly, this working together in a partnership would require our partners to feel a degree of ownership, and the relationship shouldn't be seen as a one-way street, but, if you like, a road on which you will meet each other on a par. It's already been said that we shouldn't have a fully fledged approach to all the different topics with every country, but that we should try and focus on those things that are on our minds and that are on the minds of our neighbours. And finally, we need to think about the financial planning. We've got the 2014 to 2020 framework, and within that we need to think about it over that longer term period with a sufficient degree of flexibility so that we can react to events as they happen. And I'd like to make clear in saying that the basic allocation of funds between the eastern neighbours and southern neighbours is a 1-to-2 relationship, and that isn't going to change. That isn't going to change, but within those two envelopes, if you like, we simply need a higher degree of flexibility. And things might level out, if you wish, in that period, but in Lebanon and Jordan, we have to invest massively to support those countries. And we need to think about those possibilities because of the need for a peaceful solution that would make it possible for us to step in. And to do that, we have to have the requisite degree of flexibility to be able to step in if there is a need for that, or if indeed there is the possibility for that. Another important point, which is that has become apparent, is that we, alongside the bilateral relations, need to think about cooperation at a sub-regional level. This would, for example, relate to the Maghreb countries or the countries of the Southern Caucasus, and there is an awful lot of potential there. And if you're thinking about creating peace and stability, then we need to ensure that those countries amongst themselves can pursue relations, not only, if I could put it in these terms, in a belligerent manner, but in a way that would promote exchange. And I think in saying that, certainly in the Mediterranean arena, we need to think much more about the potentiality of the Union to concentrate on that Mediterranean area and to try and streamline things. Because it sometimes seems to me that in the Mediterranean, every minister has his own format for how things are to be done. I don't think that's really been particularly effective, and the UFM has now moved in a much more profitable direction, I think. And I think under the leadership of the High Representative in the weeks ahead, there will be another meeting in Barcelona, and I think it is there that we should be thinking about UFM and the Eastern Partnership, and that I think has taken on new life since Riga. So we've already signed, that's to say, all the foreign ministers of the neighboring countries in my presence and with Federica Mogherini, and there's an invitation gone out on the basis of that document to explore with us the possibilities for cooperation. The different topic areas have been referred to in that, and I would like to stress that with regard to reporting, it's not that we wish to do less reporting, but that when there are conclusions, that they should be propagated. You shouldn't necessarily have a report every single year if there's not a sufficient justification for that. Finally, if we are going to use this very strongly pragmatic approach, then I have to say that that mustn't be at the cost of the fundamentals. We're absolutely clear about that, and we won't be shaken in our approach to that, and it's really non-negotiable. But what we do need to question here is how we ensure that we bring the principles of the rule of law to bear, and we are quite sure that a society that is free and that can develop in prosperity will mean that this can be implemented in a particular country in the right format without that country getting into great difficulties. And it has to be our objective in that to move things in a direction whereby the principles of the rule of law can be implemented on an ongoing and sustainable basis, and that institutional freedom, media freedom, and the independence of the judiciary, etc., can all be guaranteed. And an active neighborhood policy is one way in which we will be able to pursue that. Thank you.
Herzlichen Dank.
Thank you very much. We have a good half an hour before us right now. In the meantime, we have 21 or 22 people that would like to take the floor, but that simply won't work. So I think that the coordinators will be given 1.5 minutes each, and the rest 1 minute each. And then we would be able, of course, to give Madame Mogherini and Commissioner Hahn to respond to the questions. Colleague Breda, please, you have the floor.
Merci infiniment, Monsieur le Président. Merci.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the High Representative and Commissioner Hahn for their presentations. I want to welcome the proposal that was adopted today and to examine it in detail. First of all, I think that it answers in a very clear manner to the demands that we have and that we stated in the report that was done by Mr. Coquin a few months ago, which is saying that we want to have a proper neighbourhood policy that is based on common values, that is attentive to the context in each country, that is flexible for the most appropriate tailored support in each of those countries. I'm thrilled to see that stabilisation is identified as the most important challenge that we face. And I want to state once again that the real stake is how we can do stability inside differentiation. To come back to support the request made by our chair, Mr. Brock, we had an exchange with Minister Steinmeier on Monday, and we talked about the possibility of an action based on Article 222, the joint defence clause that was invoked. And these terrorist, they're not just terrorist attacks, they are linked to military aggression. And I think it's very important because we need to take this very into account. I'd be interested to know what your point of view is in terms of the invocation of the Common Defence Clause.
President, High Representative Commissioner, I would like, and please allow me to thank you for your presentation and for the text you have shared with us today. And also I'd like to thank the rapporteur, Mr. Kukan, for his very valuable work. I was in charge of the report of the review of the European Neighbourhood Policy on behalf of the S&D Group, and I also chaired the EU-Moldova delegation of the European Parliament. It is crystal clear that the migration crisis and the human tragedy of refugees is unprecedented and requires our assistance, our solidarity, and our urgent action. But my plea to you, looking at our neighborhood, is to continue our efforts to the east and to avoid east versus south dilemma by tackling present challenges with a comprehensive approach. Parliament was able to build convergence and adopt a strong and ambitious text, and by looking at the document you have shared with us and listening to you, I can see many common threads between our discussions and the questions you have decided to address. I have the following question. The review includes a number of ambitious initiatives accompanied by new instruments. How do you foresee their financing? Will there be a new resources allocated, or will there be a redistribution of the existing resources? Thank you.
Dziękuję panie przewodniczący. Dziękuję za obecność I prezentację pani wysokiej przedstawiciel.
So thank you very much for your presence and for the presentation from the High Representative and the Commission. The neighbourhood policy has got to give an important contribution to the creation of a safer world for all of our countries, and it's necessary to support the process of reconstruction of civil society in all this area. Also in Georgia and in Ukraine, but particularly in Georgia. Ukraine is a particular case. There's other problems there. But the most important question is that of illegal migration from the south. And we've got to use this opportunity of dialogue, which continues the process of the ENP, to try and convince our partners that we need concrete cooperation. And I'd like to know what we're going to do in the future to ensure that the countries of the southern side of the Mediterranean do their best to ensure that they actually do stop illegal migration. I know that measures have already been announced over the past 6 months, but these programs have not yet actually shown fruit. I think we've got to see is some proper cooperation with our partners in the south and Mediterranean. Also in Turkey, we've only seen that there's been some marginal discussion around the issue of proper cooperation to fight against this mafia. I'm thinking also about the long-term horizon. We have to think of the threats that are in fact perhaps also closer to us. We have to think about the threats that come out of this migratory flow, which is moving now towards the Black Sea, because the people smugglers are now active in Turkey, in the south of Turkey, but they could move their work towards the Black Sea. And so we also have got to ask, how are we going to use this opportunity and these measures in order to answer that?
Thank you, Chairman. High Representative, Commissioner.
1 minute, please.
Why is that?
I've said in the beginning. Oh, no, you are for your group. 1.5 minutes.
Mr. Chairman, I mean, you are known for discriminating liberals, but...
By pleasure.
Thank you. It's a good start. In fact, over a recent decade, EU's immediate neighbourhood become a very part of European Union's economy, security and migration policies. It's our common space. We can't reject any more any understanding on this issue. And in fact, we should and must consider European neighbourhood as an opportunity, not as a risk, for our better and more secure future. In fact, I appreciate very much a reasonable and very practical report you just presented to us. It's indeed in quality different from previous documents we saw on European neighbourhood. I appreciate your partnership together, bringing this document to daylight. I extremely appreciate your point on EU visibility. Finally, it's understood. We can't and we have no right to shy away from being visible once delivering on the ground and making things happening. I have 2 points to be asked and asking your side for clarification. On CSDP cooperation, do you have something in mind for immediate enacting this provision? There is still a huge need for this. And my second point, EU delegations, they play an important part in bringing EU policy on the ground. Are there any plans for more staffing and financial support for EU delegations in immediate neighbourhood?
Thank you very much. My first question concerns Syria. Or with regard to Syria, what sort of opportunities, what sort of steps are to be taken, Madam Mogherini, as concerns dealing with the government and the opposition and involving them in the process as well? And do you think that we can find some sort of counterpart among the opposition as well? Now, the possibility, furthermore, that Assad might step aside and the possibility of a future opposition government. So what do you see, what sort of possibilities do you see there? What sort of reforms might be instituted as well immediately? What sort of issues might be taken into consideration as far as establishing a more robust society? Commissioner Hahn mentioned that as well. So with regard to a more robust society, would that mean a more just society? Would that mean focusing on particular groups within society? For example, look at the case of the Sunnis and the Shias as well in Iraq. Would you see some sort of special preference for one particular group in society? We also have to take into consideration the different sources that exist, the various channels, financial channels that provide the support, of course, that Daesh needs. How exactly are we going to be able to cut off those funds to these issues? Also, the delivery of weapons. Are there any indications that there might be something going on, some sort of link with Qatar? Thank you.
Fragestellungen, das Thema.
The review of neighborhood policy, that is our focus here. So we're not talking specifically only about Syria here, but about the broader policy as concerns the neighborhood of Europe. So we'll move on to our next speaker, Madam Hotela. Thank you.
Cooperation between the two of you seems to have led to identifying new important areas for cooperation and emphasis on, for instance, on security. And I couldn't agree more with Commissioner Hahn when he has said that poverty, corruption and poor governance are also sources of insecurity. And I think this is a very good definition of where our challenges are for stabilization of the region. So, and I believe that we have to stick, as you propose, on the what you call fundamentals. Commissioner Hahn, the reform of the justice system, the independence of judiciary, anti-corruption, which I believe is very much behind all the rest of the development that we need to see in economic opportunities, etc. And when you now highlight the importance of the security dimension, then I think we have to understand that there are indeed so many conflicts in the area. South and East, that we need to invest a lot more on conflict prevention and resolution of conflicts that we have, including the frozen conflicts that we do have mainly in the East. Now, two questions. On the instruments, You say that the more for more principle will stay, but it is not a sufficient incentive to commit to reform, that it would be reserved mainly for countries that are already committed. So what could this mean in practice? And secondly, you talk about the neighbours of neighbours. Should we also, in the parliamentary cooperation, for instance, in Euronest and the Union for Mediterranean, recognise the cooperation with neighbours of the neighbours?
Grazie Presidente. Accolgo.
Thank you very much. Now, the issue of the various violations that we've seen up until now, we have to understand that not only the policy of the European neighborhood policy has to be revisited, but a number of other issues have to be revisited as well to establish some sort of equilibrium, some sort of balance. How can we ignore the issue of refugees, for example, if we're within the framework of the European neighborhood policy? The neighbors or the neighbors of neighbors, well, we might be speaking about 40 different countries, and we may be speaking about numerous different financiers of ISIS as well. We also have financing from Turkey as well in an indirect fashion, and this would be through the purchasing of petroleum which is refined illegally by ISIS. So the particular prospects that exist and the various solutions that have been proposed are to a certain extent unreal. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I very much welcome the presentation of the EMP review by our two distinguished guests. It is vital for the EU and its relation with partners in the neighborhood to set this policy on the right track. We are struggling in the period of challenges and crises which are taking place in our close neighborhood, and their effects are becoming very tangible in the Union. In my report, I have called to go to the back to basics, which means more focused involvement on the elementary fundamental issues. I'm glad that the EMP review take these and many other things under consideration. Face to face with the recent and upcoming challenges, we need to be able to react promptly to changing realities. This has been for a long time a problem. Therefore, now more than ever, we need strong, politically driven neighborhood policy. And I would like to encourage both our distinguished guests maybe to show more leadership and vision when it comes to the policy. We cannot really go on as business as usual. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Grazie. Bene la relazione, ma ho sempre...
There are a certain number of concerns, particularly because of the major events that have taken place. So we have to look at this in a rational fashion. And I think that balance between state and security, liberties and security as well, this has to be taken into consideration, of course. We have a situation which with the level has been raised. There's no question about that whatsoever. And great critical issues exist on the table before us. And I think it's absolutely necessary, of course, for the European Union to move forward as far as defending human rights. There's no question about that whatsoever. Promoting peace as well, of course. And finally, to what extent human rights, protection of individuals' liberties and security, how are all these to be... how are we to strike a balance within the new ENP? There's no doubt whatsoever that a policy of cooperation, a concerted effort, is what has to be on the table, and it is there where we have to focus our efforts. Thank you very much. But migration undoubtedly has to be taken into consideration as well.
Dankeschön, Herr Präsident. I'm very glad that we have this document, which is comprehensive, which has a lot of vision. But as my friend Kukan said before, I would expect also more leadership from our European leaders.
I think that what is missing is, and I would in this 1 minute focus on the working methods, what you, as you mentioned. We have among the working methods of diplomacy and foreign policy is prominent that we have to act where the situation is critical, where there are problems, where there are well-known problems, and where there are problems which we know for many, many years. So I would ask you, Mrs. Mogherini, to work on the concrete action programs of European Union on about the well-known protracted situations, the crisis which tomorrow can develop in a very dangerous direction. I would here mention also the protracted problems. Okay, thank you very much.
Danke. Ich bedanke mich ausdrücklich für die.
I would like to thank you very much for the proposal made by Madame Mogherini and the Commissioner as well, that proposal that being essentially that we need a new approach, a new orientation in the ENP. Looking at the, but I think we do have to focus on the various idiosyncrasies that exist, the differences that exist between the different countries as well. It's important to have a proper neighborhood policy, but we do have to look at the specificities that exist as well. And my question is, in what you propose with regard to the common priorities, economic development for stability, well, what sort of new implements, what new instruments, what sort of new approach is envisioned in the ENP that would bolster this development of this economic development in these areas? How can we get rid of, for example, youth unemployment in these areas? This is very important. That's a very important specific element. But overall, I'd like to know what sort of new approaches are to be proposed with regard to bolstering economic activity in these areas. Thank you.
Thank you. I would also like to follow those who thank you for the report. And I think there has been, as you have said, progress over the last years in the neighborhood relationship with all of them, be it east or south. Nevertheless, we are, and you have explained that very well, in a situation where some things have to be considered differently. And I appreciate, as my colleague Heidi Hautala has said, that you both referred to that, and also in the text it said that the causes of instability often lie outside the security domain alone. I think they basically lie outside the security domain. This comes sort of second. And you mention injustice, poverty, inequality, corruption, etc. But what I miss in there, and when you talked about it, but it's not in the text, the strong focus on human rights and democracy. And my very concrete question goes also to the issue of more for more. It says that we need more effective ways to engage. Now, are you willing to go on with a conditionality on human rights and democracy, meaning also less for less if there is decrease of human rights and democracy, which we have in several of the countries? So stability needs also human rights and democracy. And the second very short question on Yemen, the council conclusions are there.
Madam,
are you also working towards Saudi Arabia? Thank you.
Please, the word has Mr. Plenkovich. Please keep the time limit. It's just a question to be nice to your colleagues. Mr. Plenkovich.
Thank you very much, Chairman. Thank you, Madam Mogherini, Commissioner Hahn. I think it's a very solid document which you presented today, and you are basically with the four-year strategy on enlargement, with the preparation of the global strategy on foreign policy, with the development goal strategy, clearly building the foreign policy pillars of the mandate of this commission, and it is highly appreciated. What I would like to know is a little bit more, how do you intend to, in this state-building exercise, as far as I can see it, use the association agreements, because the two key words which I heard from today from you is stabilization. stabilization and partnership? How do we use the association as a concept in the wider region of our foreign policy? And also the budgetary means. The Parliament is sending very good signals for migration crisis, for foreign policy activities for the budget 2016, and finally the greater use of multilateral fora, Eastern Partnership and Union for the Mediterranean, all having deficiencies because of specific reasons. Thank you.
Thank you. Valencia.
Gracias, Presidente. Gracias.
Thank you very much, Madam Mogherini, Commissioner Hahn. Thank you very much for the presentation of the work that's underway right now with regard to the ENP. My question is, what we need is stability. We need to stabilize our neighborhood, but the behavior of some of the member states makes it very, very difficult to really see a concerted effort on the part of the European Union. For example, if Hungary doesn't want to partake in the refugee distribution, and if the Czech Republic as well and Slovakia as well don't want that, well, how are we going to make ourselves credible when we spout forth with regard to stability, neighbors, et cetera, et cetera? So I think, indeed, in our own house, the issues have not been resolved. It's important for us to look at our neighbors and see what's going on, but it's also important for us to look inward to see what we are doing and what sort of image we are sending outward. So I think we do have to continue with conditionality, unfortunately. Otherwise, we have to redefine everything. Thank you.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, Madame la Haute Représentante.
Thank you, Chair, Honourable Representative, and the Commissioner. Thank you very much for your presentation, but congratulations particularly for the way in which the consultations were run, because our partners have already said how satisfied they were. I think that was a very important starting point. Congratulations also for the change in approach. Less priorities, more efficiency and more flexibility. I would like to emphasise three sectors. First of all, we would like to ensure that we work on migration and security issues. What's going to happen with the setting up of a common database accessible for all of us in order to combat illegal migration? Secondly, the emphasis put on education in order to ensure that we have effective prevention of radicalization. That means we have to emphasize education. Without, of course, getting involved in the internal affairs of our partners, we can ensure that the access made in education will serve our common interest. And final question, how are we going to improve the visibility of the European Union's actions? I think that has got to be our aim inside the context of our ENP.
Thank you. Frau Gomez.
I very much agree with your focus on economic developments for jobs for the youth. But then it's important as well to persuade our member states to ditch the self-defeating austerity, which has resulted in no jobs, much alienation for our own youth, and of course, radicalization of second generation migrants. And my question is, are we going to really start coordinating ourselves, especially now that you will have to combine this neighborhood policy with military action in the framework of the Article 42.7? Are we going to have a message, only voice message, for instance, countries who have been enabling Daesh, such as Saudi Arabia, such as Turkey? Are we going to have a message you need to prevent the smugglers to actually continue their business by not opening safe and legal avenues for migration and refugees, because of course these refugees are running from terrorists like the ones who attacked in Paris, who were European terrorists, and of course migrants, it's not never been the borders closed that has prevented them from coming. And I second the question that without human rights, there's no stabilization.
Anna. Not now. I have my last sentence. This is your normal formulation. Now, the floor has Mrs. Schake. She is always a good example in time.
Thank you, President. High Representative and Commissioner Hahn, thank you for sharing your time during these difficult and undoubtedly challenging days for you. I agree with those who have expressed appreciation for the document, which is a good basis. It is very clear to us how much the neighbourhood impacts us, and hopefully we can give meaning to the relations from our side. But I'm curious to see how this goes in practice, because I think that the promise of more for more often is not quite delivered, and that in spirit it is not followed through sufficiently. Too often stability in the short term means government-to-government relations are strengthened, while these same governments repress the general population, including the young generation. And in the long term, of course, if we cannot give meaning beyond jobs to this very, very young generation all around Europe, we risk a lost generation which will come back as a boomerang. So I wanted to ask how concretely, particularly in these times where security and counterterrorism are going to be top of mind again, we can learn from the past and not make the same mistakes of trading alleged stability for a focus and clear words and a clear policy with regard to enhancing people's rights and freedoms. Can you speak more about a budget breakdown or how this is going to play out in practice? Thank you.
Good example. Mr. Killam.
Thank you very much. Our policy has been now to strengthen our security, especially on the external borders. My question is, are our declarations and plans met by adequate funding? Especially I have in mind also internal security, introducing agreement on PNR, and reintroducing data retention directive, which is very badly needed by Europol. Second question, does the EU have a strategy about Middle East, for example, for Kurdistan? I've heard that Mr. Putin has promised Rojava Kurdistan recognition. What is our reaction? And third question, we meet a very crucial choice between two evils. And Mr. Putin's plans are very clear to repeat the scenario of World War II, which worked, but had a price, namely sentencing tens of people for
44 years. Frau Gill.
And now, Madam Gill, please.
High Representative Commissioner, the EU has had a neighbourhood strategy for almost two decades now and have put in considerable resources to somewhat similar objectives. Yet when we look at the neighbourhood, it is in turmoil, it is more unstable and volatile and lacking in economic prosperity. So, and I do recognise that the strategy has been undermined by member states pursuing their different bilateral agenda. What I want to know is, how are we going to achieve greater effectiveness? You said you had a meeting with the ambassadors of partner countries. Have you got buy-in from the Council and from the Member States on this strategy? And secondly, there are very many security concerns following the Paris attacks about the ease of weapons that come in from the neighbourhood, especially the AK-47s. But I know some of the partner countries are refusing to do anything about it. So what action will you take as part of this strategy to make sure they do take some action? Thank you.
Thank you. Herr Kuso.
Grazie.
Could you put it again on?
Okay. Gracias, señor.
Thank you very much, Chair, Commissioner, Madam Mogherini. I think that the neighbourhood policy is once again going to fail. Why? Because I think it doesn't work with enough emphasis on economic symmetry. It's extremely important. We seem to be searching subordinates rather than partners in our policy. It's important that we look at the whole issue of the occupation of the Sahel. Issue of stability is important for refugees. It's important that we have the whole issue of arms sale. In particular, when we look at Article 42.7, which is the common defence policy, well, the idea is to militarise Europe in an asymmetric fashion. If we look at the whole issue of contraband, the selling of illegal oil. I think that that is the road that we need to actually combat in order to find some solutions for the future. Thank you very much. Mr. Pagnot will be the last speaker. Well, you said one and another that our policy in the neighbourhood has got to change. We've got to the limit of what we can do. And we know that 2015 isn't the same situation as 2003. The question is, how can our policy actually help stability in our neighbourhood? And I think that, you know, the anti-Europeans and the international could like it, but it's more Europe that's going to help us here. So when you look at your new policy, how are we going to work concretely with our neighbours? The Mediterranean South cannot be thought of unless we actually involve the important Middle Eastern actors. How do you think we're going to work with them? How do you think we can involve the Arab League? Don't you think that would be a good way to involve them in order to move forward? I'd also like to know what your point of view is on the possibility of the Europe-Africa vertical axis of work going right down into Central Africa, because I think it's also important that we involve them in order to avoid destabilization in our immediate neighbourhood. Thank you. Thank you much for the discussion, everyone. I think that here, you know, we're not actually going to look at all in one day. There's so much differentiation for each different country. It's going to take a period of time in order to ensure we do actually, nevertheless, in spite of a tailored approach, also have a coherent, uniform approach. At a certain stage in terms of content, we will look at that in order to ensure that we can help you to develop that particular approach. And so when we look at the reporting on this, we need to ensure that this tailored approach is also linked to a uniform understanding. From Mogherini, the floor is yours.
Thank you. The NP review is a very important part of our common foreign policy setting somehow. Some of you were saying this, this is part of many different review exercises we are having. It's a key one, but please don't take it as a magic wand for everything, because it will not be the case. You would be disappointed, and we would be. It is a very important step. It is a very important step, especially the process we have engaged with our partners in doing this, because it allows us to understand better and to put the basis for a common work that is more effective. But again, if you expect this to solve all the problems for the Kurds to Cyprus to the Middle East peace process, we have also other instruments. So very important, but put it into the context. Second, I'm sorry, Borghezio is not there anymore. So maybe no, because he was inviting not having business as usual. Maybe for him, attendance is it's unfortunately business as usual. But believe me, it's not. But believe me, I mean, there is nothing of what we are doing in this year we are in office that is business as usual, I believe, because we were just saying in the college this morning. We started by saying a new, maybe the last chance, or in any case, the new start. We have had a crisis management first year in office. So I don't see the business as usual. The business as usual is the crisis management of our days. But again, we have to keep being consistent with what we do. Because 1 month ago, all of you would have stressed migration, 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 and today is terrorist, terrorist, terrorist. We have to keep focused on the all connected and relevant risks, but also opportunities. I share very much what somebody said, that we have in front of us, and be consistent. And it's true, the partnership with our region is much more important now than it used to be in 2003, because we share risks and opportunities. And it is, together, crisis management and also long-term investment. The crisis management side, somehow, it's clear that security with immediate needs for cooperation, including some CSDP options, is something that we have to put in the picture. It's clear for the security conditions we have inside the European Union and outside of the European Union. And migration is the second one. And here, some of you refer to the irregular migration from our southern neighbors. Look at the numbers. Look at the numbers. The migrants or the refugees we are receiving
are not coming from our southern neighbors, are coming through our southern neighbors, and our southern neighbors themselves are having quite a major problem in hosting refugees and migrants. So also in this, while maybe 10 or 20 years ago we were on different sides, today we are together. We are on the same side of trying to manage the problem. That is a shift that maybe us Europeans take some time to digest. But I think it's time for us to understand it. That's, we are together with our southern neighbors in this. Last 3 points. And with the League of Arab States, we have already common ministerials, regular ones, and common summits. We try to do our best. Also, they have internal problems to manage their membership. But the real point to me is the issue of the lost generation that you mentioned. That is why I referred to, and we worked on these economic opportunities on one side, because we have this, I mean, we forgot already the Arab Spring. But the real point is that demography, economy, and the fact that we have so many young people educated, but without a proper place in society, is producing not only the migration flows, but also the terrorist threats. So either we face the role of the young people in their own societies all over the neighborhood, including also in the European Union, but this is another story, as Anna was saying, very in a very passionate way. This is the key. And here, I leave the more for more and less for less to Commissioner Hahn. But the issue is, the point is, we need to find ways together with our partners, and partners are not only the governments, are the people, as well as we are not only the institutions, we are also the people of Europe. We have to find the ways of building conditions for resilient societies. And the resilient society is a society that is open, and that is inclusive, and that is respectful of rights. This is, and this brings to security. There is no other way. And all the debate about security versus human rights is a fake one. The only way of having security is having strong human rights and openness and inclusiveness of societies. I think it is crystal clear to everybody. Last but not at all least, on Article 42.7, I'm more than ready to share not only notes, documents. My services are at your complete disposal on that. They're happy to do that. We've been working on the last 48 hours very hard on this, as you can imagine. Being it the first time that this is used requires also from us tough preparation. So ready to exchange notes and to work together, and also me personally, whenever I am in Brussels, also to have a more restricted format to discuss about that for sure. Thanks.
The speaker's microphone, please.
Borghesio hat sie.
Mr. Borghesio excused himself. He was wearing his sunglasses because he's got an eye problem, so he had to go straight to the hospital. So, sorry, he did actually excuse himself, so we understand the reason why he wasn't there for your answers. Thank you very much for the offer you made for 42.7, and I'll give the floor to the Commissioner. Don't understand, Federica, that you are responsible for more and more, and he's responsible for less and less. That's, if I've understood properly, that's the way you're splitting up the work at the moment.
Also, wir haben da eine gute Aufgabenteilung.
That's a very good split up of work, I think. I just wanted to reassure my colleagues that there's no differentiation between East and South. We have our staff, we have our departments. We are obligated to work with the individual countries. But sometimes one country, if you like, comes more into focus for a moment, and then that will turn around again. You know, on the margins of the ministerial conferences, you know, it's a pretty balanced conversation goes on in terms of the whole range of countries. You know, so I think actually we are in fact managing to keep a balance of the various areas we've got to look at. In terms of the more for more policy, I think that here we've got to push forward a rational development. It looks a little bit mechanical in fact, but what the idea is we need to have a benchmark for the internal development of each country. It's not, if you like, necessarily already looking at our already implemented higher standards as being the benchmark. That's not going to be the case. I think it's important that we help countries through this process. And the less for less, if you like, comes to fruition when we are, for example, saying that we might made not that fewer resources are made available, but fewer resources could be implemented in these environments. It's important that we always look at the promotion of NGOs and civil society. And in a lot of these countries, they play an absolutely essential role. Now, it's important that we reinforce this role and that we support their development. But here we see in a number of countries that there is a problem with the development that, you know, sometimes it's made more difficult to support civil society organizations when the support comes from the outside. That's one of the problems in some of these countries. We need to adapt pragmatically to that situation. Generally, I support everything that the High Representative has just said. We are looking at a comprehensive approach, but one that reflects the individual situation in each country so we can react to what's happening in each country. Economic development isn't just a single-dimensional approach. It doesn't just mean investing, you know, only in the economic aspect of the country. It means we've also got to look at, for example, the education that's required, the academic support that's required, the professional and vocational support that's needed in order for the economies to develop. And I think that's a very often very sensitive reaction from some of these countries, that we don't want to be seen that through our activities to be, as it were, simply sort of triggering a pull effect, that the best educated people from an academic and vocational point of view then move to Europe and in fact leave these countries behind. It's that would lead to a brain drain. And I think that in that issue of offer and demand, that is an issue we need to bear in mind. We have to deal with that issue as well. We have to look at financing startups when it's possible, in order to help people who want to become self-employed in our neighbouring countries. This is particularly true of young people. What can we do with our financial resources in order to work with financial institutions such as the EIB, the IRB, in order to ensure that we can create a degree of leverage for investment in these countries to support, for example, SMEs from the smallest countries, to provide microfinance where it's required. I think quite honestly that is a place where we need to look at the possibilities of what the implementation would be for that to work. We're working intensively on that. We're also working with the Arab League, for example. I think it's important that certain organizations are given particular attention because of their experience in this area. We think it's very important that in terms of their competencies, they also get involved, because these organizations are very often a very important dialogue partner for the European Union. We've seen this in recent months. And as my colleague just said, the work is now beginning and we've got to see the work being implemented successfully. Thank you very much, Madam Mogherini. Thank you much, Mr. Hahn, for the presentation. Thank you very much that you, in fact, give us this opportunity to talk to you before the press conference. And I want to wish you all the success in your work for the future. Thank you.